Welcome guys to the Passion Animator Talk Show, and as you know that we do these shows to educate the students, the aspiring animators about animation so that they can have the right information about the industry right away from the industry people. So today we have a very special guest, Steven, who has 4 years of experience and he has been working in DNEG, double negative in London. And he is going to share his experience and wisdom about animation today, and especially about the film. I want him to disclose about the film and share his work and his wisdom about animation. So let's get into the video and welcome our guest, Mr. Steven. Hi, Steven. How are you?
Good, good. Thank you for having me.
Yes. Great to have you.
It's great to be here.
Yes, sorry. Great to have you, and thank you so much for accepting the invite and being here and sharing the stage with us, and also educating people and inspiring them to become animators. So we welcome you. I welcome you on the show.
Thank you.
I would like to start with your journey. Like, everybody has a different experience. Somebody comes in through luck, somebody comes through destiny, somebody already knows about animation. So can you share something about your journey, how it all started and how you landed up being an animator?
Yeah, absolutely. So I didn't really consider being an animator until I was, I guess, like 18 or 19 or 20, somewhere around there, I can't remember. But basically, I was on a surf trip with some of my friends, and we were surfing on an island, and we missed the ferry home in a car, and we missed the ferry home. So to kill some time, one of my friends put on a show called The Big Les Show, which is a YouTube series, and it was just, I just loved it. I thought it was amazing. And then I thought, man, what a cool job this guy has. Like, he just gets to make this show. And then I'm like, oh, that'd be a sick job, being an animator. And so I just Googled when I got home, like, how to be an animator. And I saw there was a university course for it. So I said, okay. So I just enrolled into the university. And then I moved states, went to the university, graduated, came to London with my girlfriend at the time. And then worked in London at just at like restaurants and bars while I was practicing animation, because after graduation I was obviously still horrendous. Mm-hmm. And just kept working on the craft until I eventually got hired at DNEG. And then since then I worked on Ron's Gone Wrong, Under the Boardwalk, Nimona, and Garfield. And I did a test in between for another show.
But good to have you, and good to hear about you, that that one small thing that got you a spark about getting into animation and being an animator. So
yeah, absolutely.
Yes.
Yeah, and I was just gonna say, yeah, and it was interesting change along the way as well, because that's a 2D show. So my vision when I first started was to be a 2D animator and do 2D stuff. And then as soon as I got to university, basically, they were teaching 3D, and then I had to do the switch. But I enjoyed every second of it, and I loved it, and I kind of found what I wanted to do, which was cool.
So how do you feel about being an animator? You do the work all day, you do animation, and how does it make you feel being an animator?
So I often do think this is the best job in the world. And I sometimes have moments where I pinch myself and I'm like, this is sick, you know. But that's definitely happened, especially when I first got a job. And then every now and then throughout the films, I'll get like moments of like a large amount of appreciation. But otherwise, it's just life as normal. I don't feel any different as I felt when I wasn't an animator. But I'm very grateful that I've been able to make a career of animation, that's for sure.
Definitely. When I talked with other people as well, guests on the show, they also said, and I also feel that being an animator is quite fun, and it could be the best job in the world. Being so cool and doing this acting and then doing the same stuff on the characters, basically bringing life, that is very, very inspiring and feels good to do that.
For me, it's like you're, it doesn't seem like work. For example, if I was to draw a picture because I feel like doing a drawing, I'm going to draw a picture. If I feel like doing an animation because I'm inspired to do an animation, I'm going to do it. But for some reason, there's money appearing in your bank account. You know what I mean? For something with great people, you do cinema screenings, you have parties, and you just have this like awesome community that you somehow get paid to be in. Right, and it's super cool. And you know, I remember every other job I've had a lot of jobs. I've done a lot of different jobs, and I've hated every single one of them, because it's nothing to show for it. Most jobs, I guess, just jobs where like you just go there, you do your work, you come home, and then that's gone. There's nothing you've learned. There's nothing to take home from it. There's just nothing. You've just gave your manual labor away, and you've got nothing but besides money for it. So that kind of job is just like awful. But with being animation, you're creating art that kind of lives forever, essentially. Like, I can't imagine it dying. You've got a film to be proud of. You've got friendships to be proud of, and you're getting paid. Yeah, being creative, I think being able to work in a creative role and just create something and have something at the end, something that you can share and be proud of, is very rewarding and fulfilling.
Good to hear your analogy behind being an animator. So good to hear that. And as you said that you have worked on a different kind of projects on Double Negative, which you are working for, right? So today, what are you going to share about, which project you are going to share with the audience, the stuffs you did, the shorts, your showreel?
I'll share Nimona. Only two of the films have been released. Garfield is getting released next year, and Under the Boardwalk it's a mystery whether or not that'll come out. we don't know anything about that film, actually. It's been delayed a lot. But Nimona is the shots that I have that are out that I can speak with, that I can kind of run through. Okay. Do you want me to do that now?
Yes, we can get into that stuff. But let's get something more, if you can share, and then gradually we can get into the stuff. So whatever you did, you might have done a lot of animation since your full experience which you had. So what, according to you, if you remember any of the shot which was the most difficult for you?
Honestly, every single shot, no matter how simple it might seem, has caused me like a lot of difficulty. Okay. I'll tell you the most difficult shot that I've ever not done, and it was so hard that they gave it away to someone else to do it because I just couldn't do it. So this shot absolutely defeated me, and it was the first time it ever happened, and I felt awful. It was a shot. Oh, I don't know how to describe it because it's not out yet.
No worries then.
Yeah, it was just very complex. There was slow motion involved, a bunch of characters. But yeah, it was tough, and I was on it for about maybe like a bit over a month, and I just couldn't get it right, and so I just lost the shot, and that was a shot that defeated me. You could say every other shot that I've done, I've managed to do. So it's been hard, but I finished it. But this shot, I just never managed to finish it, and someone else had to do it. So that I would have to say that would be the hardest shot I've ever done because I couldn't do it.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. And then what would be the most interesting shot you did? Like, you got connected emotionally so much into the shot. Is there any shot like that?
No. There's no like deep emotional connection in any shots that I've formed, that I've done. No, I haven't really done any intimate moments for that to kind of be a thing. A lot of my shots, I would say, are very heavily body mechanics. I've done, of course, I've done acting, but I haven't done any kind of in-depth real serious acting in any of the films, I would say.
Okay. No, I mean to say, like, which any shot which you enjoyed the most, you got really connected that, yes, I should do this, or that really got you it.
Okay, so just a shot that I enjoyed doing and it was like a breeze to work on, super fun, having a great time. That would be... I don't know, because I get challenged on them all. It's never been an easy kind of like, just do it. It's never been like a very thing where I can just say that this is amazing. But there's been shots that I've had fun on for sure. Like, but it's always towards the end that I start having fun. Mm-hmm. Like when I'm just in the polish and I'm just making it as good as I can. And that's kind of my favorite bit. Mm-hmm. Until then, it's kind of like a slug, just trying to get it to mm-hmm. work and be good. But yeah, I enjoyed, there's some shots, actually the first time I got given like a challenging shot or like a decent shot, I would say that was pretty amazing. That felt really good to be trusted with a shot like this and to do it. And that was really fun. I could say that, but that's also not released yet. So I can't really talk about, I guess, what the shot contained. It was on Under the Boardwalk.
Good. So now maybe you can share your work and share how you did it. Maybe something you want to share about how you did that stuff or how you started, how you got into that.
Yeah, absolutely. So do you want me to share screen? So I'll just quickly go over these shots that I did mm-hmm. on Nimona mm-hmm. and just some of the things that I did, like techniques, some of the notes I got from the directors, some of the versions and the lessons I learned. So I'll just turn it down a whole bunch. So the shots that are in gray were animated by other animators. I didn't do the shots that are in gray. So mm-hmm. I'll just play the first shot now. Mm-hmm. So that was the first shot. Wasn't the first shot I did on the film, but it was a shot of this sync sketch. So what did I do? First off, you can see there's like seven characters in there, maybe six. So there's a lot of characters, and when you have a lot of characters, it gets very heavy in the scene. So it's very hard to animate a huge lag and delay whenever you try to do something. A lot of crashes, which is annoying. So to start off with, I used cubes to create the layout, if you will, to kind of stage everything. And I did that across both shots so that these are all cubes at the start. And once the directors approved the cubes, I went into the rigs. And I'd kind of focus on one at a time, like Ballister and this guy, or Ballister and this one. So basically the idea behind this shot is it's Nimona being a bit of a menace, right? So I thought it'd be fun. There was this pizza throw wasn't like in the boards or anything. That was just something I thought would be cool if you threw pizza at their face. And I'm glad that made it into the film. It was a bit of a fight to get it in there, but we got it in. Some of the things, I'll just mute it while I talk. Some of the things that I was told to focus on here is the direction. Mm-hmm. So, you know, everything's kind of pointing up at this, mm-hmm. this pizza, so we know where to look. Mm-hmm. And then we had to remember as well that Nimona is super strong, so the bin is very light to her, and she's able to just mess these guys up. So that was probably about all the notes I got for this one. And then in this shot I spent a lot of time on. This shot was a mission. This kick was not there for a long time. Before the kick, she pushed this knight, hit these knights, but didn't jump. And then this wasn't a kick. This was another push. So I had the same baluster doing the push again, and it just wasn't working for the longest time ever, and I couldn't get it kind of to work. So I asked Goku, who's an amazing animator, for a hand to see what he thought. And basically he said, this kind of sets up for a kick, because I did have the jump, but I didn't have the kick. And he said, it looks like you should kick. And so of course it flows effortlessly into a kick. Mm-hmm. So once I got that note, I was able to finish the shot basically, because it was finally working. A note that I kept getting throughout the blocking and the spline was to make it very lyrical from Nick, which meant I have rhythm, I believe. And so that's the kind of the beast of this shot. It was challenging to animate all the knights, to keep them doing something and have them all animating. Like, this knight that gets up here is not, you know, there's probably like a different knight. Like, I was just moving them under the camera. They were doing all this crazy stuff, if that makes sense. Yeah, can't remember that. But yeah, the key thing to help me do that shot, I would say, for people that are listening, is to do a tricky shot with complex characters, with a lot of characters, just with cubes first, and get the cubes working before you jump straight in with the rigs. And in terms of reference, I didn't shoot any reference for this shot. I did try, but it was just wasn't really working, because, you know, I just had a pillow and it was just garbage. So I didn't do it. I just animated.
So how
and
did you
this
manage?
Shot. Yeah.
How did you manage so many characters? Was it really challenging?
Yeah, it was challenging. It was challenging because of the lagginess that you get and the crashes. So if you had a crash and you had to copy all the animation into a new scene, I've got to copy it with 7 characters. It takes a long time. But in regards to animating multiple characters, the cubes are what you need to focus on, because the cubes will give you the positioning and everything basically. And then you can just turn the cubes off. So I would leave, let's say these 3 were cubes and this was a cube, and this would be the rig and this would be Bao. And so the rest would be cubes, and I'll just focus on 2 characters at a time. And then I'll turn his cube back on or leave him on. And then this would be the character I'd work on with them. So with that and any sort of shot, I think it's best just to break down break it down into smaller bite-sized pieces to make it more achievable. But you do need to have that all working at the start, because it makes your life a lot easier. If you spend too much time getting these 2 characters perfect without knowing anything about these, you could run into some issues further down the line.
Yeah. So when you create cubes, do you really animate it completely, or it's just basic blocking we do?
I animate it completely, because it's a cube. It's not very hard to animate. It's just up and down, side to side, bit of leaning and stuff, bit of squash and stretch. So it's not like a huge amount. Basically, I just need to know exactly where all the characters are and what they're doing. So it's easy to show that with a cube.
Okay.
Right. I just saw a brilliant animation from Alex. I can't say his last name because I can't remember it. It was on LinkedIn. I could probably find it. But he just did a shot with 2 cubes fighting. And it looks great. You can see everything working. I'll try and find it towards the end. But that just shows you the power of what cubes can do. You know, you don't need arms and legs. You just need cubes. So you can show the whole shot working very well with cubes. Yeah. So you do animate them for
you. Okay.
Sorry?
So when you finish off, it's just to see and not make the file heavy, right? When we use cubes.
Yes, exactly.
Okay. And once that is approved, that okay, this is how the action is looking, then we actually do that kind of animation on the character?
Yeah.
Okay. So that's an easy way of handling the file, which is having many characters.
Yes. Yes. And even characters that even a file with one character, sometimes I might use a cube first because rigs are slow and you can get away with a lot more with a cube. If for example, if I was to run and do a backflip, I could do it with a cube very easily just by like shrinking the cube. You know, I can make it look really nice. Yeah. But with a character, you can't really make it look nice without putting in the poses and making effort. But a cube can share your idea very clearly. And so it's a quick way to communicate your idea. And then you can also, if you do it well enough and you, the proportions are correct and stuff, you can just parent the character to the cube and you'll have hopefully a bit of your animation done for you.
But if it's a single cube, then how can we parent that with the whole, are you talking about parenting the cube with the hip? Or the pelvis.
Yeah. So for example, if you have a character that's this big, so that's how big the character is. You're not going to use a cube this big. You're going to maybe you'll put a head on it, and then you'll have the cube the size of the character, and you can move the pivot here if you want, which is the same as the character. So. If you do the cube doing a backflip or a front flip and you parent the character to it, the character is going to be in the correct spot for the, it's about the cog, the center of gravity.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Does that make sense?
Yes. So yeah. then we hide the main cube.
Yeah.
Okay. That's an easy way of, handling the file as well as making animation a little bit easier, the process.
Yeah, absolutely. I have a, let me show you. Let me pause this share for a second. I have a file where I did it that I can share with you, just to show you an example of one. I didn't end up animating the, sorry, I can't multitask.
I had seen once, but I actually could not get it, that how does it get implemented or switched with the character? I had seen once artists animate the cubes and get the... I thought that it's more about just conveying the idea to the director or the supervisor and getting it approved.
Yeah, it is. But if you do it with correct proportions and you put a bit of effort into it, as you can just parent the characters it's not going to be perfect. You're still going to have to do a bit of work and you might tweak it. And maybe sometimes you can't do it and you do just have to animate it anyway. But sometimes it works, which is nice.
Okay.
I'll show you this. This is an example that I did. I never animated it, but it's kind of like a layout that I did. So you can see hopefully how these cubes kind of tell you what the shot's going to be. Okay. And how you could put the characters where the cubes are and get the spinning and the time and the location in the world space of the characters and stuff.
Okay. So you were trying to animate on the song.
The shot, but then I got hired and free time went out the window.
That was Callum's spot, right?
I believe so, yes. Yeah, I think so, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's nice. I might still do it one day.
Yeah, I just got to hear that. I love that song. I used to sing earlier when I used to have that.
Oh, nice. Yeah, it's a nice song for sure.
It's a nice song. It's like the lyrics are climb every mountain and climb every mountain, swim every ocean, just to be with you, fix what I've broken.
That's
I need you. Do you see? You are the reason.
Nice, dude. Rock and roll. It's awesome.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I love singing. That's another.
Yeah. Yeah, you sound good. Yeah. Yeah. Likewise. I used to be a musician before I was an animator.
Oh. Same like that. Then our things match quite a bit.
Yeah.
Well, singer.
Yeah, I think you might find a few people, musicians on the side. And I think it does help with timing and rhythm and just having nice beats in the animation, which is cool. Because if you already understand that lyric, you know, with music, it's just about converting it to animation. But if you need to learn the whole thing from scratch, it might be a bit more challenging.
Mm-hmm. So this is this is the shot where you had a lot many characters. Like, was there anything else also with a specific single character, or maybe other shot, or this was the only one?
So this one is interesting. This one, these knights. This one sucked because it's on the frame for 24 frames.
Mm-hmm.
Which is just 1 second, but I had to animate 15 characters.
Oh.
Right, so I had to, you know, it's 24 frames with 15 characters, and you watch it,
mm-hmm.
it just goes by in an instant. It's like one of those shots that you just it's there, but mm-hmm. you know, it's over. And it took me a long time to animate because the scene was so slow with so many characters. It crashed like five times. I had to copy the animation to new scenes like five times, do all the constraints, do everything. And it just took like over a month or something, crazy long time to animate this. And this kind of shot for me, it was, you know, I wanted to spend all my time on this shot. This shot was more fun for me to animate than this one. This was a tough shot to do, but it's done. This shot was also challenging. Some little cheats. You can see that if that was to carry on, she's got her hand through the wall.
Mm.
So that was a tight space to kind of play with her arm reaching in, getting an axe without the axe coming through here.
Mm.
So that was something I had to worry about. And then if you listen to the dialogue, she's quite she's got a bit of oomph in it. So
one of the club's about to get
some
new members.
So I animated that very differently the first time. I had like an axe throw in there so that the one-armed club through the axe catches it and it's like about to get some new members. So it's very animated. Mm-hmm. And the director said, whoa, tone it way down. What are you doing? So, you know, and so I did. But I took the axe throw out, but I kept the kind of the body like pushing the dialogue out. And then he said, no, you're still doing way too much. And then he just wanted it to sink into this like little devil demon Nimona here. So as you can see, she grabs the axe and then she just hits this pose and just shrinks into it. And then she barely moves out of that. Well, she lives in that pose the whole time. And she doesn't really do a whole lot. So it was a bit challenging, but awesome. And then when I first animated the shot, she was running to about the stairs. And so we had to sacrifice some frames from somewhere. And then she would run around here. And it was a bit weird. And it was only when we got to, when I didn't have to get her to there, that I had enough frames to kind of make everything else have enough time without feeling rushed.
Mm-hmm.
So that was cool. This shot was really fun. I would say that this shot was really fun to animate.
Sometimes when we don't have the frames to do that acting, so how do you handle that kind of shots or that part where you have to show something but there are not enough frames?
So depending on the shot, like if there's not enough frames and everything else is working but you need to see the extra frames, then generally they'll just add extra frame to the shot. So they just say add 10 extra frames so you can do it properly. If you've got enough frames and you just need to tweak your animation, it's just a case of tweaking your animation, stealing frames from here and there to make it work. Mm-hmm. And specifically if it's musically timed as well, like if it's in like got sound effects and beats and stuff, sometimes you have to do it in the frames because the score has already been done to the shot, for example, so you can't add the frames because it's going to ruin the flow of the shot. Mm-hmm. So then you just have to pick and choose where to add frames. However, this one, there's a lot of quiet times. I can't remember. I just took the frames from the end because she was running to like the stairs, and I just made her finish here, which meant that I had a whole bunch of extra frames to put throughout the rest of the shot. So I think I just used the frames I had in this shot.
Is it still there? Like, can you play the full stuff once if you can have the complete video played?
Oh, I didn't play the shot, sorry.
One of the clubs about to get some new members. Get it? Oh, too soon?
Yeah. Okay. And then this shot was the first shot, the first two shots that I got cast on the show. So I'll just play.
Something,
we win. Yeah, so that shot was the first shot I got cast, and it was challenging because this was one of the first times we saw demon teeth and how she would be. And initially when we worked a fair bit on the shape, and I had something that looked like this.
Okay.
Like super wobbly. And it was approved by the directors. And but it got sent back to us from the art director or the dude. He said it's off model from the Mona. Mm. And then he gave me a nice draw over. So I just had to match the draw over. This shot was a lot of fun. I don't think I had too many challenges with this shot. This one was pretty straightforward. This one I had a lot of fun on. If we want to go back to your first question, which shot did I have a lot of fun on? I'd say this one. This one was just like a breeze. Not a breeze, but like I enjoyed working on it. It was entertaining and fun. And then this shot was tricky to do because the tree, the background was, I kind of needed to see the background to have all these trees on, which made the scene heavy again. And then I animated it at one stage and she was landing not in a good position when we turned on the trees. And so I had to change it. But what I did with this is I just parented the global control of the armadillo Nimona to the camera and just tweaked it. And then this pose here, when she's flying through the air, I did about 7 variations of different poses for the directors to choose from. Again, I had this a bit more complex than it had to be, but in the end, we chose this pose. And in the first version, in the boards, she was an armadillo here, and she actually did the first bounce here as an armadillo, and then she turned into Nimona in a backflip here and then did the slide. So she hit the ground first. And it was very challenging to make work. And then I ended up doing the transition in the air here and having her land as Nimona instead of having that extra bounce. So that was something that we changed. And I got to do a superhero landing, which is really cool. I was really happy to do that. So that was really fun. And then this was surprisingly challenging to have Ballista come in and stop like this. It just, you know, it just took a bit of feedback to get right from the directors. I didn't nail it for a long time. I was kind of just having him just kind of come to an easing stop, but it needed to be more like he's cruising and the grass catches him. I don't know how to explain it, but it didn't click with me instantly. So it took a few tries to get that timing right. It's as simple as it might look, and you know, the stuff with his hands and his feet coming over the grass. And then a little lesson that I learned on this shot, I did this hill click that we have here, and the directors really liked it, and then I took it away and I did something else for some reason. Like I think I just thought I had a better idea, and it was much better than this. And so after they already said, like, this is awesome, I went back, worked on it more, I came back with something else, and they're like, what the heck, where's the hill click gone? Put that back, you know. And that was a little lesson to me not to change things once the directors say they like it, you know. Basically the time for experimentation had finished and I continued to experiment with the shot.
I too like that action which you did, that legs one. Yes, this one.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's cool.
Typically, we try to do something with the body or maybe the hand gestures, but you did something with the legs. So that was quite different for me. That's why I really liked that part. And in between, did you switch the characters where that bounces?
So you can see when they switch.
Yes,
it's just a case of swapping them.
Hmm.
So for example, Nimona is right here right now in the chest, and she just comes out of the chest, and now the armadillo is in here. I was very lucky. The animators did obviously some really amazing transformations, but mine is just Nimona like ball to Nimona ball. If that makes sense. She's just going into like another ball here, so there was not, it wasn't that I had to match the arms and shrink the face into the face or anything like that. So it was pretty easy for me to do that transformation.
Okay.
That's it. That's what I've got to say about these shots. Hopefully that was helpful.
Yes, absolutely. That's so much in detail. So this looks so simple to animate, but I think that you might have had a lot of challenge in this as well, the slide thing. It looks so easy.
Do you mean Ballista here?
Yeah, this one, yes.
Yeah. No, I didn't, like, it wasn't like I was dying. I just didn't get it right for a little while. So it's just more challenging than it had to be. But definitely that was not the hardest part of the shot, that's for sure.
But still, it's like, it feels so easy. Like, we just have to move it from here to here. It's just a slide. We don't have to do anything with the legs or hands or chest or nothing. But still.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's those kind of tiny shots sometimes that catch you off guard when you think it's going to be simple, and then it doesn't turn out quite simple.
Hmm. So whatever you do, the animations, like whatever shots you get in the animation, how do you start with it whenever a shot is assigned to you? What is your process of doing the shot?
Changes depending on the shot, but I think one of the main things I do is you watch the edit, the layout, so you can see the shots before and after, because sometimes you animate a shot in your own little bubble, and then when you finally check it with the two shots either side, you realize you've changed the emotion or it doesn't hook up or something like that. So I like to watch the shots before and after to make sure I know how it's flowing throughout the film.
Mm-hmm.
And then depending on the shot, it would depend on what I do, whether I shoot reference or whether I start animating, or if I put some blocks in there first and start doing that sort of stuff, or if I do some thumbnails. Yeah, you just got to know where it is in this, where you are in the story and what the shot's for. So, for example, if I go back to the shot where Nimona and Ballister are about to face those knights, for example, the Nimona was keen to like mess these people up, like she wants to kill them, destroy them. So that's where her head's at. That's why she's like, demon, let's get them. And Ballister is, you know, he's wrongly convicted. So to him, these are all his homies. These are all his friends still. So he's, you know, he doesn't want to hurt them at all, but he has to defend himself, right? So that's why at the start of the shot, he's kind of like, all right, like, let's do it. And then she says she's going to cut their arms off, and she's like, oh. And then Ballister is like, oh, get out, and runs away, you know, because he's not about to cut his friend's arms off. So knowing those kind of what's going on in their brains helps you animate the shot. Mm-hmm. So if you do that with other shots as well,
So do you search references, or you try to act out like most of the times?
I don't search for reference ever, because I don't even know how you would start. Like, if you want to find something specific, like, you just type in like the thing you want. Maybe you might get lucky, but otherwise you'd just be watching a bunch of YouTube videos or whatever. And it seems very counterproductive. In terms of reference, in finding things from reference, I keep a little bank in my brain or in Instagram. There's a lot of times I'll watch a clip and it'll be awesome, and I'm like, that's really nice, there's some unique acting, there's a weird head turn in there or something, and I'll save it for reference to come back to. So I've got a library of clips that I can refer to, but I never go looking for a shot specifically for a shot. I just have a bank, and if it comes in handy, I can draw from it. If not, I'll just act it out myself. And then sometimes I just animate straight away and just play and just have fun and just experiment without reference.
So what do you think, if you have to share with the aspiring animators or people who are willing to become animators, so how does a reference make a difference? Is it okay to not have it, or is it more important to do the acting?
Well, I have to say, honestly, with the four films I worked on, I didn't really shoot a whole lot of reference. But that's because, like I said, it was very mechanics heavy. And so it was, and I couldn't act out the body mechanics because it was crazy stuff, right? Like, I couldn't do it. So I just had to animate it. And I just had to do it in Maya. So there was a fair few of my shots where I just went and had fun. And then even the acting ones, like, I like to act on if I know what I want to do, I'll act it out, but I won't film it. I'll just act it out and kind of see what I'm doing. I feel what I'm doing, and then be like, oh, I don't know, and then put it in the computer. Sometimes if I film something quickly, I'll just leave it on my phone to look at it. But I never put it one-to-one in Maya, so people that have it next to the camera and the character, I never do that. I always just keep it on the side. Because I know what I want from it, and then I just do it. So I don't need to see it next to the thing that I'm doing, because I'm never copying the timing one for one. I'm just using it for certain things that I like. But I really like shooting reference. I think when you're shooting reference, it's really nice to get the first idea, that the one that you envision out, film it, it's done, and then film it again, changing the what's in your mind. So, you know, the first one could be you're happy about it, whatever the situation is. The next one could be you're sad, or you're angry, or you're jealous, and the way you act is different. And then when I'm watching the reference, I like to look at the things that I do subconsciously that I'm not trying to do, because it's very rare. Sometimes you get into it and you're acting and you're kind of just doing what feels natural. Other times you're just doing what you think you should do. But in amongst that, you're going to do something natural that you're not trying to do. And that's what's going to be nice, that you can pinch from the reference and put in your work.
Yes.
Like a little eye scratch or like a twitch or something. So you just pick these little things from it and then put it in your work. But I think reference is important starting out, definitely, because if you, for example, with all the shots that I did, I guess I could animate fairly well from at that point. So I understood how mechanics work and the principles. So I was able to see what was wrong, why it wasn't working, what needed to be done, and I was able to build it in Maya. But if you haven't done mechanics with reference, you wouldn't be able to probably do that because you don't know why something is not working, and then you haven't studied the mechanics of movement enough to do it without the reference. So if you're starting out, for sure do reference, but I would also do exercises without reference where it's just fun, just you know, just do a run and backflip or something, you know, just some fun stuff, just have fun, and then do it with reference, do it without, you know, just mix it up for sure. But if you're starting out, I think definitely you should use reference 100%. And even like if you can use reference throughout your career, definitely keep using it. It's just times when you can't use it that it's good to be able to animate without it.
So have it ever happened that you might have done a lot of work and then you might have got some conflicting feedbacks?
Conflicting feedbacks with like my supervisor and the director, or like two different people telling me different things. No, I can't think of any times when that's happened, but at the end of the day, the director is the final say. So he's at the top. It's his film, or he or she. So if they say, do this, and your lead says, do something else, well, your lead's not going to tell you to do something opposite to what the director said anyway, unless you do variations. So you show what the director wants and then show what you wanted to do and then pick which one. But yeah, they get the final say. So that if there's conflict, you just listen to the one that you have to listen to, and that's it. But yeah, I've been told to do things from a lead like before the director's seen it, and the director's said it was all wrong, you know. But that happens with any case. It's just you go for an idea, it doesn't work, and so you do something different. And so sometimes, yeah, you lose a bit of work.
So sometimes while doing the shots, we get too much into it and we get stuck with a thought or an idea. So how do you overcome in that case when you're stuck with a thought or an idea while animating?
What's your question? Sorry.
Like when we do animation, sometimes we get stuck with it, right? Or on a particular idea, or maybe while doing something, it's like very much stuck and we can't think about anything apart from that stuff. So how do you come out of that thoughts?
Okay. So when you're stuck and it's not working and you can't progress with the animation, so you just can't get it right for some reason. So that's what I learned the hard way when I did that shot that I couldn't do. I couldn't get it right. And basically I did that by myself all alone. And I was just here, you know, I couldn't get it right. I was just pulling my hair out and just like getting upset, going for a walk and coming back, you know, new day, still couldn't get it right. Getting sad, getting annoyed, feeling crap. And eventually they took the shot, right? And after they took the shot, it was a huge weight lifted off. Like I felt like, I don't know if you've ever quit a job that you hated, but that's what it felt like when I lost that shot. I was just so relieved. And but then I knew after that never to do it by myself ever again. And that if I'm ever stuck, just to message my friends, the leads, the supes, the director, just be very vocal about how you're feeling and why you're stuck. And you'll be able to get help so quick, because it's just, the only reason you're stuck is like some weird reason. Like it's to somebody else, it's very obvious what you need to do and they just can tell you. So after that, the next time I got stuck, I just told my lead. I was like, hey, dude, I'm having one of these times where I feel like I can't animate. I've got no idea what to do here. I can't get it right. And so he just put extra effort with me. And he's like, try this. And he just kind of held my hand a bit until I was on a good track. And so I think you just have to be vocal about it, because if you keep it to yourself when you're stuck and you can't get out, you're going to get frustrated and sad. But if when you talk about it, they're going to say they feel the same. They've had it before and, you know, they'll help you out.
Good. It feels good when somebody understands us in that kind of situation. that yes, it's really not working, and you need to maybe take some rest or maybe figure out something. If there is a person who can understand your emotions at that point of time, it's good to have that support.
Absolutely.
So actually, one thing I was very confused with dealing with the camera animation and the character. So when we have a chasing sequence, suppose the camera is tracking the character's movement and the character is running, suppose. So in that case, what is the first thing we finalize? The camera animation or the character animation?
Camera. So you get the camera given to you already animated. And so sometimes you can tweak it if you need to. But when you get given a shot, you get the characters. Generally, they're static in the scene. Mm-hmm. And then you get the camera moving. And then you just have to animate the character with the camera, because the camera has been already done with layout to go through the whole film, right? Because there's all the other shots to consider. Mm-hmm. So you can't really do that as you go, because nothing would hook up correctly. Mm-hmm. So that's all already done for you. So the animation comes second, and you just have to match the camera. And then also there's like a final pass where they make it perfect. Mm-hmm. And sometimes you can change it if you have to. Yeah. But yeah, that's a good point. Sometimes when I've struggled a whole lot, it's because I wasn't touching the camera. And as soon as I got permission to touch the camera, I stopped struggling because I could make it work. Yeah, so that's something you should be vocal about as well.
Mm-hmm. Good to hear that. One emotional connect I just want to ask, like, there are so many artists who dream about working in these big studios and on some feature films which get released worldwide, and people are able to see those films. So it's really a proud feeling, right, for working on that kind of films. How do you feel being associated with these kind of films when you see your work being picturized in a theater worldwide?
It was amazing. When I first went to the cinema to see a movie I worked on, I was like, holy moly. And that was just a screening, in fact, because I don't think Run's Gone Wrong. Oh, it was in the cinema. Yeah. It was just amazing to see my work in the screen, and then, yeah, it was amazing. But then one thing that I found a bit underwhelming was the credits, you know. And I think it's an interesting thing, the credits, because you see quite frequently people get upset when they're not credited on a film. Mm. And to me, it's the least of your worries. I think I'd be upset if they didn't show any of your work, because it's more important to be able to show your work than it is to show your name amongst a thousand others. Mm. You know, it's very underwhelming to see your name. And I don't understand why everyone's so iffy about the credits. I guess if you don't have something to take from the film, like if you're in like a production role, then you probably want your name on the credits or something. But as an artist, I'm more grateful to be able to share my work and watch my work. And the credits, I don't really care about the credits. So that's something that I found underwhelming, that I thought I would be like, whoa.
Yeah.
Yeah. But watching the movies is amazing that you've worked on. It feels like a dream come true for sure.
Because people see the work. There are a lot of people who don't even wait for the credits. So having the short scene is a major thing, I guess.
Exactly. And nobody, absolutely nobody besides other people in your role care about the credits. So for example, I do watch the credits, and I watch the animation credits only. I don't look at anything else. I just look at the animation, like the animators, yeah, and I try to see who I'm knowing or something, you know. But that's because I'm in the industry. So all the rest of the world that are not in the industry, as soon as the movie's over, they're gone. So if my name is missing from a film, I don't care at all. As long as I've got the work to show for it, then it's totally fine. So yeah, it's a weird thing that the people want credit in the credits. I don't say people shouldn't be credited, but I just think if they're not, it's not a big deal.
Yeah.
Depending on the role. That's just my opinion. I'm sure a lot of people would disagree.
Yeah. But good to hear your opinion. I really like the way you think about being an artist and watching, because I've seen so many people get so attached to the names that my name is there, But again, there are a lot of people who see their names, but they are not happy to show their work, which was shown in the film. So it's just about the name they are happy about, but they're not willing to show that what I have done in the film.
Yeah. That's like a ego thing at that point, I guess, isn't it? Yeah.
So good to hear about your perspective as an animator. I loved it, whatever you shared. So like in India, we have so many people talking about, I want to work in Pixar, I want to work in Disney. These two names come at the very first picture when we talk about animation. So what would you like to share for these aspiring animators? How can somebody, a fresher or who is starting his journey, can get into Pixar or Disney-like studios?
Well, I can't answer that because I'm not in Disney or Pixar, so I wouldn't know.
Any big studios if somebody has to get into, what kind of work or what is it that they need to focus more on, like that?
Yeah. So we just released with Lupin House two interviews with two animators that teach at Lupin House. One's from Pixar and one's from Disney. And I asked the exact same question. Mm-hmm. And they said, the Pixar animator, Andrew, he said that the first thing to do is not make that your goal. You know, that shouldn't be your main like focus. But basically, you have a understanding about character specificity, basically, like acting and stuff like that. So basically, to get a job at DNEG or any animation studio, you just have to be good. You just have to be able to animate. You have to be good. You're just not going to get a job if you suck. And there's a reason for that. It's because you're getting paid to do a job, and if you can't do the job, why would they hire you, right? It's that simple. Mm-hmm. And so to get at one of these studios, you just have to have an amazing reel, a good reel. And to get a job at Disney or Pixar, I think you have to obviously have a good reel, but then you have to go a bit deeper than the reel, and they have to really see like the acting choices that you've made and all of that kind of really deep stuff that takes you out of just being an animator and about the performance, right? I'm assuming, like I said, I don't know because I didn't work there. But I think if you can show acting, like the main thing is that when you're watching an animation, I think, is that you're watching a performance and you're not watching animation. And so if you can really deliver authentic, believable performances, then that's what you're going to get hired. That's why you'll be hired. So you just have to be good, I guess, and be able to, and you know, be able to create compelling performances.
And apart from being good into the art, what do you think about being as a person? Suppose if a person, how much do they, or if you have any idea about this, that how much do a company or a studio would understand a person, who the person is, rather than being into what the work is doing?
Yeah, so you have to be able to gel with the studio, I would say. Like if you had an interview with someone and you came out of it thinking they were just an awful person, you're probably not going to hire them. But if you come out thinking they're amazing, they're really friendly, they seem like passionate, all this kind of stuff, then for sure they're going to hire you. But then if you get hired and you are an asshole, then you're probably not going to last very long, you know, because you got to be a good person, right? Like they're not going to keep you just because you can animate, because there's someone that can animate that's also a nice person and a team player. So they have to make sure you're going to gel with the studio and all the employees and be a nice person. But, you know, you'll have no trouble if you're a normal human being, like nice person, you know, if you're just mean you know, like no one should have any issue with that, really. I don't think everyone, if you just stand like standard, like when I say standard, I mean, you're respectful, you're polite. You clean up after yourself, you know, if you do the dishes, you're courteous for people, you know, all this kind of stuff, just general being human, then there should be no reason why you won't be hired.
That's a beautiful share you shared, and I loved it. So that people, whoever is willing to get into any studios, they should focus on themselves as well, apart from the animation skills, like how do you talk, how do you behave or respect people, instead of being entitled that I'm this person. Mm-hmm. That a lot of people yeah. have this mindset of I'm this guy. This is what I have seen. So, thank you so much for sharing that it's very important to be a good person as well, apart from being a good artist.
So absolutely. Mm-hmm. Yeah, in life, I think that's the most important thing. Mm-hmm. Just be nice. It's nice to be nice.
Thank you so much for being so humble and being here.
Thank you for having me. It's great.
So, and a lot of people have this confusion about the softwares, like because it's a different country and they are working on some great feature films. So it's a confusion that whether they will be using some personalized softwares or is it only the Maya majorly in all the studios?
I think in a large majority of the studios, it's just Maya. I think Pixar and DreamWorks have their own softwares.
Okay.
And I think Disney recently moved to one of their softwares, I think.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that those studios have different softwares, but DNEG uses Maya. I think most studios use Maya.
Mm-hmm.
There's really no other one. There's Blender, but I don't think a lot of studios use Blender.
Mm-hmm. Yes. So.
But the software is not important. I see that question a lot, and it's entertaining to see when you post like an awesome animation and someone says, what software did you use? It's not the question to be asking because it's obviously, you know, animation is animation regardless of the software. And if you would be able to do the same thing on any software. So it's the wrong question to be asking.
Yes, absolutely. You shared the right thing. And this is what I generally tell to all the students here as well, that people come to me, but this question I ask just to clarify so that when somebody sees this episode, they also know that, okay, it is not like that everywhere. And I also share this, that it's not like that. If you know animation, you can do it in any software. Software is just a tool that is going to give you some things, how you animate. I give them a very simple analogy about relating it with the toothbrush. I tell them that which kind of toothbrush do you use? Paste. So do you use a different paste for every day? And they're like, no, we use the same. So it's the same thing. It's different softwares, but you brush the teeth the same way, like this only. Whether you use this brand, that brand, whatever the brand is, the process is the same.
Absolutely.
So that is a good thing that you shared, that you need to focus on the art of animation instead of being technical, more of it should be more of performing and art, how the character feels, how they should behave in a particular situation.
So, yeah, absolutely.
Good. Nice to share that. And thank you so much for coming here and sharing so many things. Now I would like you to share something about Lupin House and how it all started. What thought did you have about Lupin House? And why that name, Lupin House? Is there any story behind that?
There is actually. The reason Lupin is it's a legume, a bean that they have in France and probably other parts of the world, but not in Australia. So basically my girlfriend at the time, she was in Australia and her parents sent her a box of like French stuff. And there was these Lupin beans in there. And I was like, what is this? You know, and I ate it and it was cool. I loved it. And so I really liked Lupins. So when it came to thinking of my name for the school, it was just Lupin House. And I like House as well because of Tonko House, which is a studio. And I thought Tonko House is cool instead of like Tonko Studio or like Lupin Studio. I think House is really... it's a bit cooler, so I changed it. So that's where I got Lupin from, and that's where I got House from. So Lupin House.
Oh.
Yeah. And I felt like it worked. You know, like some names don't work. I feel like this one did, so I just kept it. But it wasn't a school straight away, Lupin House. Lupin House was my studio name, for example. I wanted to have a studio. I was going to do like freelance work. When I did my short film, it was under Lupin House. I tried to start a YouTube series. It was under Lupin House. And so when it came to starting a school, I just used Lupin House because I already had the name. Yeah. And when it came to starting the school, it was interesting. It was always my goal to do. And my goal was to start a school after, you know, 10 years in the industry. And I was like super advanced, worked on a whole bunch of films, and I had stuff to share. And then I thought to myself, what's the point of waiting 10 years to do something? It just seemed stupid. And I thought, if I wait 10 years till I'm ready, then I'll be starting from zero at 10 years. But if I start now, by the time I get to 10 years and I'm ready, I would have already had 10 years of practice and doing it and growing. So I started it, and then I couldn't teach people that were better than me because I wasn't the best, right? Like my skill set was, let's say it was at a 5, and I needed to teach people with a 10. And so that's why I started hiring mentors, so they could teach the people that I couldn't teach. And so when someone would send the showreel, if they wanted to, this is at the start, it's changed now. But at the start, there was a beginner, intermediate, and advanced classes, and I picked 2 teachers. So one was advanced, I was beginner, and the other one was intermediate. And so if someone was like absolutely beginner, they'll get a lot more from me than they would someone advanced, because as in they would get the same from someone advanced, but they're missing out on their, what they're there for, basically. Yeah. So I would take everyone that was very beginner, and then I'd put, if I watched someone's showreel and I couldn't see anything wrong with it, I would just pass it on to another mentor. Mm-hmm. But then I didn't like telling people that they were not good, because some people would apply for an advanced mentorship and they were not good. And I'd say, you know, you're better suited to this one or this one. And I thought it wasn't very fair. And so I changed it to choose your mentor. And we all teach intermediate, beginner, and advanced. So if they want to go with Danny Gonzalez, then they can just go with Danny. If they want to go with me, they can come with me. So I let people now choose the mentor. If there's space, they can have that mentor. So people pick 3 mentors. If they can't have the first one because they're full, they'll go to the second one. And generally by 3, you'll get in with whichever one you can. So yeah, that's why I have the mentors. It was because I couldn't teach at the time more advanced stuff. And so that's kind of how it grew. And then we kept growing and growing and growing and needing more mentors. And it turned into a school when initially it was kind of just a mentorship program. It is still a mentorship, but it's growing a lot bigger and a lot faster. And I've got bigger plans for it than I started with initially. And yeah, I'm really glad I didn't wait 10 years to start.
Absolutely. The same thing I did. I didn't wait. The same thing exactly what is happening is I can teach people who start, again, not getting into the complete advanced level. But yes, definitely better than whatever other people are teaching in the whole country. Right. So India has a lot of lack of awareness about the quality of animation. If you go and watch some YouTube videos, it's going to be like, you can't even call it as animation. It's like what kids do. Kids can do better animation than that. Right. And people see that as animation, like just head turning around this and that. And I feel like, what is this? There are so many capable artists, but there is nobody who is coming up and taking an initiative to either coach or mentor the aspiring animators. At least we struggled. So those people who are trying to get into the industry, having a bigger goals, they should have the right direction if somebody can guide.
Yeah. I think mentoring in any industry will replace schools.
Yes.
Eventually, that certain jobs you need a certificate or whatever for, like if you're a doctor or a lawyer. So it's these kind of jobs you need the certification. But any job where you just need to be able to do the job, I think mentorships are going to replace universities, because you're learning. Most teachers, you could say, are not in the industry that they teach in. I know some would be, but a lot of them wouldn't be and are not. And so it's much better. Any industry, if you want to learn to become a farmer, go learn from an experienced farmer. Like, don't go learn at a university where you pay thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars. Mm-hmm. So I think mentorships are way better than any sort of education. And if I was going back to the start of mine and I knew what I knew now, I wouldn't go anywhere near a university. In fact, I think universities are a huge scam, especially in the animation industry. I think they're not adequate. They just don't leave anyone ready. Unless you go to like animation mentor or anim school, which is just specifically animation, or the discipline that you want, then you can probably graduate and get a job. But at a university that's government funded, where you can do like the pay now, go now, pay later, or any kind of scheme, they're all crap. Like I had to do so many essays. Before I could graduate, I had to take a course in an elective, which was nothing to do with animation. I had to do rigging, lighting, texturing, modeling. I had to do so much crap. Not that's crap, but all this other stuff that was not animation. And so when I graduated, I sucked at animation and I wasn't going to get a job. And a lot of people get discouraged at that point, and a lot of people are not disciplined enough to keep their education on their own. That's why they have university. And if university doesn't prepare them enough, then they're just going to, like a lot of my colleagues, I think I'm the only one out of my class that is an animator in feature film or an animator at all. The rest of them changed degrees or they went into like, architecture animation or something else. Not there's anything wrong with that, but I was the only one that like, we all wanted to be feature film animators and I was the only one that went and did it. And that's because the uni left us all at the same spot, but it was hard. And they just went and did easier careers where you could go to uni, get another degree, which would guarantee you a job, you know? And so, yeah, that uni sucks. And I still owe them a lot of money.
that is the same thing happening here as well. Like students are getting scammed. Absolutely. Like they are taking out money from their parents, which can't even afford that much of money. But they are taking that money from loans or maybe from banks and then putting it into the universities and the schools and colleges, where I have seen so many inquiries coming in for me for teaching, but they have done their graduation in animation, BSc in animation and something like graduation courses, but still they are not aware about being an animator, that I don't need to learn modeling, texturing, lighting for being an animator. And that's a scam, big scam, that if a person spending 3 years with you don't even know how the industry works, then why is he even there?
Yeah, and the level as well. I went to Annecy recently this year and I had a stall there basically promoting Lupin House. And it was full of a lot of people that recently graduated or they're graduating, and they were not very interested in Lupin House at all. They were in that section for a job and looking for jobs. And I'd watch their showreel, which was nowhere near hiring. And I would say like, yeah, you probably need to have an acting shot with some lip sync in your reel before, you know, but they just had no idea. They were just so naive and they were like not interested at all in furthering their education. They're like, no, I've just graduated. I've had enough. Which is totally fine, but these same people are they going to apply for jobs and they're not going to get the jobs. But the key thing is they didn't know that. So they thought because they graduated that they're ready for work, when that's not the case at all.
Yes.
And they just still need to do further study or study on their own to get to that level. And so that's where schools are letting people down, because they've got this expectation to get a job, and then they say that the industry is competitive and it's super hard to get a job, and it's not. If you're a good animator, you'll get a job. It's that simple. And the reason you're not getting hired is because you're not a good animator. It's not competitive. You're just not good, and that the problem is it stems from university, where people think that they're good when they don't get taught what good animation is, or they can't see it. And so that's why Lupin House exists, to bridge that gap from university to your first job, or from your, you know, junior to mid, just to help you level up with people that are working in the industry.
Good, great, great thing you are doing. So I am so much inclined to what I'm doing and what you're doing. It's like the energies are matching. That's why maybe we are here together on and sharing and talking about this, because the inclination of what we want is at the same point. Maybe you are in a different country, I am in a different country, but the thinking is the same, what we really want for the aspiring students, so that they don't get scammed and they can save a lot of money and time and still get a job, which is better than what they are struggling for in 3-4 years of time.
Yeah, absolutely.
And what would you like to share? Would you like to share about the thing which you are working on, the animation framework?
Yeah, so that is another step from Lupin House as well, because I was preparing them for a job, let's say, like helping them bridge that gap, but then cutting contact essentially. Like there's nothing else I could do to help them get a job, but like there's no connections and stuff. And we've managed to get a few students work from recommendations that sometimes the mentor will recommend it to the studio and they'll get hired. So a lot of our students have got jobs, which is really, really, really cool. But I feel like there was a bit more. And the industry as a whole is very challenging. Lots of turnover. So there's a lot of people constantly on your newsfeed, especially now being laid off. But before that, it wasn't about being laid off. It was just about their contract would finish and they need a new job. Mm-hmm. And it just seems like it's an industry that needs a bit of help, organization. So the animation framework is designed to connect the industry completely in one place and also allow studios to find talent a lot quicker and easier. So the animation framework is more for recruiting, right? So for the artist, it's about being there to be recruited. It's about having a profile, having your work there. And there's some cool features for the artists that I can go into, but it's mainly for the studios or for an individual trying to hire someone. Mm-hmm. So the benefits are a studio can have a studio profile, they can post ads, they can post jobs. Mm-hmm. And when people apply, they can filter what they need. So for example, if someone's applying for a job in London, they need to start right now. So they can put out a job ad. And when you put out an ad, you get thousands of applicants, and a lot of them are in that graduated stage where they just graduated, or they're, you know, for some reason, when I posted an ad that I needed mentors, I got like 50 responses and none of them were mentors. Like it was just like people trying to work for me. It was so strange. So there's a lot of fluff. And so this is to get rid of all the fluff and kind of sift out to the golden people. So you can filter. There's many, many, many filters to find the perfect candidate. But yeah, some of them is, you know, you can Google from years experience level, the previous studio they worked at, the previous project that they worked at. You can search by the type, the role, that where they have a visa, when they're available. Can't recall all of them off the top.
Is it for the specific location or it's for the everybody across the globe?
It's worldwide, but you can filter by location. Like for example, in India, if you just want to hire in India, you can just click people in India. So you just see the talent that's in India. So you don't have to, you don't apply and then you get 100 applicants and 70 of them are not applicable because they live somewhere else. And then you don't have to waste time looking at them and stuff. So you can just filter, because everyone's entering all this information when they onboard, when they sign up. So if you want someone in India, and you can just filter to Indian applicants. You know, and then if you want someone from a mid-level, you can filter to mid-level applicants. Mm-hmm. And then if you want someone that's got experience in VR, you can click VR. So then you can go down. There's a whole bunch of filters just to filter through and get the best talent. And there's a verified filter as well, because anybody can say anything on the internet. I can say I worked at any studio. I could say I'm a senior. I could say I've got this experience. You know, you can lie, right? So this is where the verified filter comes in, which I think is going to be very powerful. So artists can opt in to get verified, which means someone in their field is going to go over their profile, their reel, and verify that they are who they say they are and that they're capable. And so that's a filter that studios can use as well. So if they get 500 applicants, they can click verified, and then they'll get
200 applicants that are definitely who they say they are. So they might look at these ones first. And then if they can't find what they want, then they might look into the ones that are not verified. Mm-hmm. But the filtering system is just going to make studios be able to find the people super duper quick. And then there's a whole bunch of hiring things as well that they can do. So, like applicant tracking and stuff like that. So it's like a dashboard and all these systems and stuff. So it's really heavily for the studios. Mm-hmm. But for the artists, some cool things are project search, for example. So you can search for a movie or a film or a game or anything. And you type in, let's say you type in Luca and you say Riggers. You can see all the Riggers that worked on Luca and you can click their profile, watch their reel, save them. And you can message anyone as well. So there's no friend request or anything like that. So you get access to the industry, which is really cool. So you can message anybody. And whether or not they reply, it's up to them. But you have the opportunity to talk to anyone, and you can search through the films to find these people. So that's something I think is really cool for the artists. Mm. And then you have the explore page, which is just going to have, for the studios, it's going to be featured artists, so they can see featured artists that are amazing, like recent posts and all this kind of cool stuff. And then for the artist, it's going to say featured jobs and latest jobs and the best matches. So you'll get matched to things that suit your criteria that you set, and you'll be able to see jobs a lot quicker. So it's literally just about connecting the studios with the artists and having everything in a platform. Mm-hmm. So it's going to be very efficient. And that's just the first version. There's a million other things that we're putting into it that are going to be in future versions, but it's for we're just to get it out there. This is kind of the base, and it's the cool thing is it's going to be for everyone in the industry, not just animators, not just riggers. It's going to be for production workers, sound designers, everything. If you're a part of an animated film, you have a profile, and if I'm a producer or if I'm someone that's looking for a team, I can find my whole team in the framework, which is super cool.
That is super cool. That is going to change the way the industry is working currently. And I would like to thank for doing that, because that's something you have done very, very incredible about animation and for the people who are coming ahead in the industry. That's really going to help, because I was also thinking quite a long back that in animation industry does not have any specific location for jobs. Like, and normal websites don't understand the animation language. It's not only 3D animator or modeler. It's what art people understand. It's way different than what these jobs are all about. So
exactly.
It's great to hear that, what you shared. So would you like to share your future vision about Lupin House? How do you see Lupin House 5 years down the line or 10 years down the line?
So I want it to be the one-stop shop for someone. So if they want to be an animator, they can just go to Lupin House and go from A to Z. And go. When I say A to Z, they go from A to their first job, And so getting them job ready is the main thing. And that's going to involve, we're releasing courses that are going to be given to our mentorship students and pre-purchasable to other people outside of it, but it'll be given free to people that do mentorships. So that's coming very soon. And we're going to go backwards, though. We're not going to go forwards. So because you can get a lot of the ground knowledge of animation on the internet for free. There's no point in me making another walk cycle tutorial. There's no point in me doing a bouncing ball. There's no point in me doing overlap. All of that stuff, there's plenty of amazing tutorials on the internet for free. Mm-hmm. So we're doing our lectures backwards. So we're starting at the advanced lectures. So we're going to do, shots that you'll see in a feature film with crazy cameras and multiple moving parts. Like, how would you tackle that? So we're going to teach shots that you would come across in a film, because when I started animating, I was animating on a flat ground. I never had a ground that was not even. So it's very easy for me to do a walk or anything, because I just had to zero out the feet, for example. Everything was balanced. Mm-hmm. And then you'll find as soon as you get in an animated film, you're in an actual world where you've got a hill and you've got something that's not, easy, for example. And so you have to know how to animate on uneven surfaces. There's all these creative things that you never do because you're just animating to a static camera, doing your shot very easily. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of challenging things that I found in feature film that I wasn't ready for because I'd never practiced it. So mm-hmm. our tutorials are going to be very heavily based on feature film shots that you might be given, acting, performance, mm-hmm. Body mechanics, and we're going to go backwards. And I don't know that we'll ever go all the way to the bouncing ball. I think we will, because if we want to be A to Z, we're going to have to do that, but it'll be the last thing we do. Mm-hmm. So basically we're just going to start here and do the most advanced stuff we can, and then just slowly go backwards into its mediocre. Mm-hmm. And that's the goal. So basically there'll be courses, there'll be mentorships, and it's all going to be taught by professionals, and then expand the portfolio of characters that we have as well. We want to give our students as much variety in character as possible, and assets and libraries and environments. So I'm going to provide them with everything so they can do feature quality work.
Mm-hmm. Great. Yeah,
that's the plan.
Great to hear your plan, and it's somewhat inclined to what I am envisioning for Passion Animator. But yes, you have started your journey. I've also started my journey as in here in the country. So yes, universe is there with you, with me, and all the good people who are trying to do something great and change lives and do something better for the society. So
yeah,
thank you so much for sharing everything, whatever you shared, and your time, especially coming here. And just, I loved it, whatever you shared, being so transparent, so humble, talking about your experiences. So before closing this episode, would you like to share any particular thing which you would like to recommend or maybe suggest to the aspiring animators?
Yeah, sure. Join the animation framework when we release, when we launch. Make sure you're part of that. That's going to help us grow. So that's just a bit of promotion for this. And also for people that are basically, like the reason to promote mentorships in general, the reason why I think they're more powerful and that you people should do them is because one of the things I like to say is all those shots that I showed you before, they were the culmination of everybody's efforts. You know, not just me by myself. It was five different people giving me inputs and helping me be great. And so there's no point to do it on your own, trying to do great work. You need to have that input. And the internet is not a great place to find it for free, because the people giving it are not always they might not be giving you the good advice. They may not be qualified to give you the advice, or the advice just may be their personal preference, you know, and then, you know, there's a whole bunch of reasons why. Mm-hmm. And so the best thing about mentorships is they give you a glimpse of what you're capable of if you are working in the industry. So if you're getting mentored by one of our mentors at Disney, you're getting the same notes that they're getting. You know, we're just regurgitating the stuff that we're learning onto our students. Mm-hmm. So it gives you a good implication of what you're capable of, basically. Mm-hmm. And so I think that's why mentorships are great. So if there's any animators out there that are struggling to get a job, or they're just like not moving forward, then that's the perfect candidate for a mentorship, and I recommend kind of pursuing mentorships in that regard.
So thank you,
and happy animating. Have fun.
Yes, happy animating. Don't be technical, be the cool guy.
Yeah, just have fun, because it's challenging, and if you don't have fun with the process, it's not a great job, because it's like it's all about the process. And it's, so yeah, sometimes obviously you're going to get stuck and frustrated, but overall try to have fun as much as possible and think outside the box.
So thank you so much. I'm really grateful for your time and whatever you shared about your experiences. This is definitely going to help everybody who is watching this episode, and all the audiences, animators, do join the mentorships, because that is something that is going to change your life, not the schools or the colleges.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you. It's been awesome to chat with you and be here. It's been awesome. Thanks so much.
Thank you. Thank you so much.